Yes, sir.
So, good afternoon to one and all present in this session. Welcome back to the session number session to IoT system management. So, in this session, we have with us Dr. Mohammed Saifullah. So, let me please introduce to you Dr. Mohammed Saifullah has done his MS by research from IIT Madras, Chennai, and PhD from Anna University, Chennai. Sir has received various honors and awards. Some of them are Cisco Star from Cisco Systems, Bangalore for outstanding performance in software development, and a gold medal from Academic Excellence from Ministry of Education, Society, Hyderabad. Sir, specializations are in the network traffic engineering, Internet of Things, network management systems, data center solutions, and the software-defined networking. Sir has published four papers in reviewed international journals and presented eight papers in reputed international conferences and also in reputed national conferences. So this is a brief biodata about Dr. Mohammed Saifullah, sir. So may I request sir to take on the session, please.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for the kind introduction. Good afternoon to all the participants and welcome to this session. In this session, I will be talking about IoT system management. The outline of this talk is my PPT visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah, thanks. So the outline of this talk is first I'll talk about what is the need for the system management, and then the well-known protocol SNMP, and after that the network operator requirements. After that I'll present about NetConf and YAML. Then we will see the flexible and powerful network architecture and also OFConfig. So what is the need for the systems management is, as the network is growing, we know already that we have so many devices into the network. So whether it is the wired networks, wireless networks, or the IoT networks, or specifically the IoT devices are so many. So how do we monitor them? Sitting from the one place, how do we monitor it? Monitor the network devices and finding the performance of the network devices, and also automating configuration. That 33 is a typo, sorry for that. Automating configuration of the devices. So how do we, instead of going to each device and device manually, can we configure the devices sitting in a central place or automating it by the software? So monitoring not only operational data, statistical data also, improved reliability while applying the configurations. How do we ensure the reliability? And system-wide configuration, can we take the whole configuration of a system? Multiple system configuration, having a different configuration. So for one time we use one configuration and then the different time using the different configuration. So I'm retrieving, reusing the configurations. So can we retrieve the whole configuration from the management system? So if I want to retrieve from one box or one device, so can I retrieve the whole configuration and reuse it for a new box, new device? So these are some of the requirements or the need for the system management. As the name is very well known, SNMP, Simple Network Management Protocol. It is widely used. It is very well standardized, because it has been in the operational and production systems since long time. It has been standardized very well, and it is universally supported. So it is extendable, it is portable, it works in different architectures, and it supports the role-based access also, the administrator access or the operator access, and it is the lightweight protocol. Lightweight protocol in the sense, as it uses the UDP, it is simpler. So these are the advantages of using the SNMP. As I already said, it is very well standardized. There are so many RFCs on this SNMP. This is just to show that there are many RFCs. If interested, these RFCs can be looked into. And as already said, SNMP is a well-known network management protocol, and it allows monitoring and configuration of network devices, whatever has the IP access, that can be accessed through the SNMP, because SNMP runs on the TCP/IP protocol stack. And the SNMP components are management station, network management station, NMS. We'll see more in the coming slides. And managed device. Managed device means any network node. So like the server or the router or switch or any gateway or any IoT device which has the IP access. We'll see if there is no IP access, what to do, or there are different cases we'll be looking into in the coming slides. And management information base, it is acronym as MIB. So this is the kind of database. So this actually keeps the data of the device in the MIB format, because SNMP works in the MIB format. We'll see more details in the coming slides. And SNMP agent that runs on the device. So the server or the process which runs on each device. Each device means any network device. So that device needs to run this agent. So that is called SNMP agent. If you see the right hand side figure, the green is the network management station NMS, and the users interact with the NMS, and this managed device is nothing but any network node which runs SNMP. So the managed device will have the SNMP agent and the management information base, MIB, because this is the database. I mean, this is the online database or the online data, which is actually accessed through this agent and then sent to the NMS. So this is the high level view. Let us see the network view. The network diagram is, we can see the infrastructure of the SNMP in this network diagram. So as I already said, any network node is the managed device. So this is the server or the laptop or the switch, router, server, gateway, whether it is wired or wireless. So these are all managed devices. So these runs the agents, and these will have the MIPS, the data. And one system can be the managing entity, that is manager or network management system. So we can take the analogy of web server, because we are used to web server. So agent is the server, and manager is the client, like you can take the any browser. So, and whatever the data goes in the agent, web server is through HTML and as the web pages. So the MIB objects are like the HTML pages, and the protocol there is HTTP, here the protocol is SNMP, and the format is there HTML, here it is SMI. We'll see what is SMI and more details in the coming slides. So request and responses goes from the NMS to the network devices, that is managed devices. So NMSs, there are multiple NMSs. Well-known NMSs are from the HP. There is an HP OpenView, and IBM has its own product, Tivoli. CA has UniCenter. Cisco has Cisco Works. And NMS Networks, there is a company. It has a Signet INMS, Integrated Network Management System. And there is a company called AdventNet. This is also famous. AdventNet WebNMS. It is very extendable. And Juniper has Juno Space. There are many more. These are very, very well-known few names I have written here. This is basically to inform that there are many commercial NMS products. And let us see, as we are into the educational domain. And yeah, it seems there are some questions. Let me take a look at question now. Okay. Are there any questions? Yeah, no problem. So the open source NMS, open NMS, as the name itself is self-explanatory. Open NMS is the world's first open source enterprise grade, because multiple commercial enterprises are already using this. And the goal of this open NMS is truly distributed, scalable management application platform for all aspects of management. FCAPS, we'll see what is the FCAPS. This software was designed to be highly customizable to work in a wide variety of network environments. This can be looked into. I mean, if you want more details, you can go to this webpage, www.opennms.org. The documentation and many details are available, and it is freely downloadable. As I already said, it is an open source NMS. So any NMS needs to follow this FCAPS. What is FCAPS means? F is for fault monitoring, and C is for the configuration management, A is for accounting management, P is for the performance management, and S is for security management. So this is the ISO standardization which has given the functional requirements of any NMS, that is FCAPS. So let us see more details of each one by one. Fault management means NMS needs to manage the network problems to keep the network running reliably and efficiently. How means? So it has to do the following steps. Detecting the problems symptoms. Problems means whether a device going down, or link going down, or a system memory going up, or CPU going beyond the limits, like 90% or 100%, any kind of problem. So that problem needs to be detected by the NMS, and it needs to be isolated, and it has to be serviced automatically, or it needs to be informed to the operator. I mean, maybe by the SMS or email or phone call, whatever means. So whatever means NMS supports. So all this needs to be logged. Logged means there needs to be a record of these problems, so that one can actually take the corrective actions. So this is all as part of the fault management. And the configuration management, it needs to monitor the network and system configuration information, and also it needs to store the configuration management into a database. So how many interfaces are configured in a router? I mean, just for an example, if we take a router or a switch or any device, in the device how many processes are running, or how many other devices are connecting, all that, whether it is hardware information or the software information, all that configuration information needs to be monitored. So it's already said. So the configuration, whether it is a software or the hardware configuration, or the contact information, the persons, users, or the places, and the location information, and it needs to support the hierarchical maps also. Hierarchical maps means the hierarchical in the campus wise. For example, if we take our campus, the campus wise you will have different labs, and each lab, if you select that one, the details of the lab needs to come. Let us see if we can take a look at the live demo of the OpenNMS. We'll try to that because it is available. And the device will have different information. These, I mean, this is just an example. The actual information is much more. So that is about the FC, and A is for accounting management, and it needs to measure the network utilization parameters in order to regulate individual and group users. Means how much is used, whether it is from the system point or whether it is from the link or any other resources. So what is the utilization so that it can be built? And once we have the record, it can minimize the problems and maximize the fairness, means of who is using, how much they are using. So all that policies can be applied by looking at the accounting management or the accounting records. And performance management, it needs to maintain the network performance, means what is the acceptable level if there is an access link. So how it is performing, how much is used, whether it is to the maximum, I mean overutilized, or whether it is underutilized, so that the decision can be taken. So the performance units can be throughput or the user response time or the link utilization and others. So the performance management involves three basic steps: gathering data relating to key performance variables. So the if we take the link, for example, the link utilization. So the incoming octets or the bytes or the outgoing octets, means that is how the SNMP provides the data. So these bytes needs to be collected, so that these needs to be stored into the database. So the NMS needs to have a database. It needs to periodically collect the data from the managed devices, that is network nodes. And that data needs to be analyzed to determine the normal performance levels, so that whether it is performing in the normal way or whether it is underperforming or overperforming needs to be decided by looking at the data that is collected from the network nodes, and determining appropriate performance thresholds for each variable, so that exceeding these thresholds indicate a network problem worthy of attention. So we need to have a threshold also to say whether it is normal or not. So if we take this graph, here there are so many lines. So if you look at the bottom of this graph, so it has the counter. Each counter, the processing time or the disk time or the page per second, the memory or the byte received, the link utilization. So how it is performing over the time. So this trend can be looked at by looking at the performance report. So this is just an example. It can be any parameter. So as I said, it is extendable. We can have our own parameters. In fact, SNMP provides multiple parameters. We will take a look at more in the coming slides. So performance management can be reactive and proactive. Reactive means when performance becomes unacceptable. Means like we have the thresholds, as we said in the previous slide. So if the threshold is exceeding, then it is not acceptable. So that is reactive performance management. But proactive management means as we are periodically collecting the data and storing into the database, by looking at the data itself before something problem happens, by looking at the previous data, we can actually predict. So that is proactive. I mean, in fact, if we take the link itself, by looking at the previous data of the link, we can actually predict what is going to happen tomorrow. But that requires a lot of data collection and also the appropriate algorithms to be used. And the security management, the security access needs to be controlled. I mean, who is accessing the devices, whether they have the authorization or not, whether it is intentional or unintentional, unauthorized access. So this needs to be logged, and it needs to avoid the unauthorized access to the devices. So all this needs to be monitored, and the required policies needs to be ensured, and all the events needs to be logged into the database. So that security monitoring, the event collection needs to happen from the network devices. It is through SNMP, or it can be other protocol also. We will see the other protocols. So event needs to be analyzed and correlated, and depending on that, the alert needs to be generated. So the alert handling, I already said, it can be an email or SMS or a phone call. It can be any type of alert. So let us take a look at the OpenNMS screens or the video for better understanding of the NMS, because it already supports multiple protocols, whether it is SNMP or NMS, or it's NMS. OpenNMS is already managing hundreds of thousands of IoT devices also. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the link for this live demo is demo.opennms.org. So this gives the a feel of the OpenNMS. They have the live demo already set up in this link. Maybe network problem, it is not coming. Or at least like a look at the, I already have some backup for that. Are you able to see this YouTube video?
Yes, sir.
We have this thing called Newts, which allows us to do pretty much, as long as you're willing to build a big enough cluster, you can store as much data as you want. SNMP data collection, here's a nice little graph. We have an integration with R, which is a statistics package, which will do trending. So as you can see, my bandwidth is actually trending slightly down here. I've monitored tons of things. This is our soda machine. In the lobby of our office, there's a soda machine. So when someone buys a can of RC Cola, I actually get a notice. And when we get below three cans, my office manager gets it. Here's database. We have customers doing millions and millions of data points every 5 minutes. We have an integration with Grafana. OpenNMS was the first third-party plugin for Grafana. So if you like Grafana, you can get OpenNMS data and present it. We also have a thing called OpenNMS Helm, which is a Grafana-based application, which allows you to manage one or more OpenNMSs from the Grafana user interface. Again, based on our API. Now our goal is we want to monitor the Internet of Things. We want millions of devices, billions of metrics. And the way we're doing this is we have a new piece of software called a Minion. And it's like a little IoT device. I run them on these little NetGate PFSense boxes. And the idea is you can distribute these out. They're redundant. They're failover. They're pretty stupid. You can unplug them, plug them back in. But what this allows you to do is remote data collection, and then you can roll that up into a single location. We have one customer that's monitoring 10,000 events a second using these minions. Flow data, and we're able to do, so it's kind of cool. Here's resources, because I'm out of time. There's a bunch of resources here, pets. And so we've implemented this thing called the Business Service Monitor, which allows you to monitor your business services based upon the individual elements. Now, this is for a web service. Again, I will post these online so that you can actually see them. But the idea is you can build up your components. You can do this manually, or if you have the relationships somewhere else, you can write a script that uses a REST API to actually go through and build these business services for you. Data collection, we collect. If we can pick it up on the wire, we collect it. OpenNMS is agentless. You do not have to install anything for OpenNMS as long as we can get to it.
Yep. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
That live demo is not connecting, no problem. This is just to give the feel of the OpenNMS. So from the protocol point of view, SNMP has three parts. SNMP protocol, we'll take a look at it. It has multiple operations. And as I said, taking the analogy of the web server or the web protocol, HTTP, the data is communicated over HTML like that. Here it is SMI, Structured Management Information. We'll see more in the coming slides. And the data is stored as an AMI, Management Information Base. These are the three parts of the protocol. And the network nodes, these are called nodes only, and there are different types in this. One is managed node, means it supports the SNMP, that is SNMP agent is running on that. And management nodes means NMS is running on that node. But there are some nodes that are not manageable by SNMP. Means, let's say for an example, you have a printer or any other IoT device, and maybe other camera. So it is not accessible over IP, or there can be any proxy SNMP agent for that. Just an example I'm giving. So it can be any device which is not on the network, but as a proxy device, it can actually support the management data. So already said managed nodes or can be any servers or any devices. So these actually take the request from the NMS and sends the response. So management nodes, that is a client, you can say, or NMS. So these actually collect the data and then do the FCAPs, whatever we have seen in the previous slides, FCAPs functionality. And as already said, the nodes which are not supporting SNMP, they need to be managed by the proxy agents. So the protocol operations are get request, get next request, get bulk request. These are sent by the NMS to the agent. So to collect the data, to collect one object, it is one. The next object, you know the address of one object and you want to collect the next object of that, to that. That is get next request. We'll see what are the object or the how they are actually ordered in the coming slides. So get bulk request means you can actually collect multiple objects within a request. That is get bulk request. And set request, you can set the information also. For example, you want to select the location of the device or the name of the device or the user of the device, or just It can be any information which can be writable. That is the set request. And response is whatever, once you give the request from the NMS, then that is sent by the agent. We'll see the network diagram to understand more these operations. Trap is the, from agent, it goes to the managing entity, that is NMS. So whatever we are talking is between the NMS and the agent, that is server. So the request goes from the NMS to the agent, and response comes from the agent to the manager. So this is how the normal data collection happens in the NMS. And this is the data collection, but what about the faults? Faults are problems. So let's say the device going down or the link going down, that kind of operation, manager may not be knowing it. So the agent needs to send the data to the manager, that is NMS. So it needs to be listening. And NMS needs to have any trap daemon or the SNMP trap daemon. So that will be listening on one port, that is 162 port. This data collection is on the 161 port, like the well-known ports for FTP. We have two ports, 20 for data, 21 for control. Like that, for SNMP also, the trap information is sent over the 162 port number. And the actual data collection is on the 161 port number. So SNMP uses the pull and push information as already described. So the NMS, the management system, pulls the data, that is the collection of the variables, whatever we have been talking about, multiple variables are there. So that variables are collected by the manager and they are stored into the database. And the push model is for the traps. So agent actually pushes the information whenever some fault or some emergency happens. So as we are saying, the data is modeled by the SMI, that is structured management information. This structured management information looks like this. It has its own data types also. So the basic data types are in the right side. They are very straightforward, and each object needs to be defined by the object type. So it will have its own data type, and it will have the status, whether it is supported or obsolete, and semantics of the managed object. All that is in the object type. And the module entity, every module has its own identity. Module means group of object information. So we will see what different modules also, how they are, what is the module entity, how the module is defined also. So the basic data types are integer, integer 32, any integer. Integer 32 means, as the name itself is self-explanatory, 32 bits, and unsigned 32 integer means it is only positive. Octet string means any bytes, any octets. Object identifier, not 20, that is a typo. Object identifier means data can be object identifier. We will see what is object identifier, because every data object has its own identification. That is .1.3.6.1.2.1. like that. Every object has an identification, so that is the type of this object identifier. We'll see more. IP address, IP address, and counter 32. Counter 32 is different from the integer 32. As the name is counter, like the time goes counting, it increments, it goes on incrementing, it will never come back. So that is counter. For incoming octets or outgoing octets, it will keep incrementing only. So that is 32 bit. But for the faster devices like the GBPS speed, so that requires counter 32 data type. Because within a second, there will be millions of packets. So that is counter. This is different from the integer. Gauge 32 means if a value goes within a range, let's say within 10 to 20, if it will be oscillating, so that type is gauge. And time ticks means the time is measured in the time ticks. Instead of the seconds, minutes, hours, it will be time ticks. So time tick is 100th of a second. So the time is measured in the SNMP as any time ticks. So these are the basic data types supported by SMI. So SNMP MIB looks like this. We'll see the whole MIB itself as an example. So a module will have multiple object types, and module has its own identity. MIB module specified via SMI. And so this module identity, there can be hundreds of standardized MIBs. We'll look at it, and more vendor specific also, because every company will have its own MIB, like Cisco or Juniper or IBM, or any company will have its own device, and each device may have its own MIB, or for each group it can be a different MIB. So objects are specified via SMI, object type construct. We'll see the example of object type construct also. So in this slide, we have an object type example. So this example is IP in delivers, means in the IP module, incoming delivered. So syntax is counter 32, as we already explained you the data types. This is an counter 32, means it will keep incrementing only. Maximum access, it is read only, whether it is read or read write, or so what kind of access it has, this object has provides. This is read only, means the counter will give only read access. We cannot set that counter. And status is, it is current, means it is supported. The agent gives the value, but the status can be obsolete also. That means it will no more it is supported. And the description of this one, because it is in a very different format, right? IP in delivers difficult to understand, but here the description is there. The total number of input datagrams successfully delivered to IP user protocols, including ICMP. So this is the description of this object type. So this is what the object type construct, and it will have how it is connected to its parent, IP 9th child. We'll see how the MIB is actually organized, how, what is this child, and it looks like a tree. We'll see that example. And module entity has its own description. For example, if we take the IP MIB module entity, last updated, when this MIB is last updated, so that is the 94th year, 11th month, and the date, and minutes, and seconds. So this is what the type, the last updated time, and the organization. What is the organization which has created this MIB? And the contact info, who has created it, and the organization, the person, and the description. The MIB module for managing IP and ICMP implementations, but excluding their management of IP routes. IP routing MIB is different. So that is whatever may be the description. So the description of the module comes here, like the each object has its own description. This is module-wise the high-level description. And what is the revision? When it is last updated, and what is the revision, like 1.1, 1.2, like that, it can be a different number. And in the hierarchical MIB, and what is the connection for that hierarchical MIB? Let us see the actual MIB so that what are these connections of the child numbers to understand more. So MIBs are organized like this. OSI has given this tree structure. So the base is ITUT organization, ISO, International Standards Organization. It is a, this is 0 and this is 1. And joined ISO ITUT, so it has the number 2. So starting dot 1, that is root, dot 1 means ISO. Dot 1.2 means ISO member. Dot 1.3 means ISO identified organization. So So .1.3. So in this, USDOD, Department of Defense, Open Source Foundation is 22, NATO Identify ID 57. So every system needs to have this basic information. That basic information is called MIB2, that comes from ISO, and 3 is ISO Identified Organization. In this, the DOD. DOD, because internet is developed by the Department of Defense, that is why the whole internet comes under the DOD. DOD in that internet management, so the internet can be a directory or experimental, private, because every company can have its own private information, the security information, SMTV2, like that, there are multiple groups. So in that MIB2 is this, in the management information, this MIB2 has multiple groups. Multiple groups means the system information, means what is the system information, for example, the user or the location or the how many processors are running, what is the CPU or what is the memory and all that. So that kind of lot of information. We'll see the example of MIB where you can understand easily. Interface means how many interfaces in the each interface, the incoming or outgoing or the NTUs or the protocols, multiple details of the interface. Like that, the address translation. Address translation, because Ethernet address, the interface address is translated to the IP address. So that is this address translation group will have that translation. The IP, like as already we have seen an example of the object type IP in delivers. So this IP MIB will have all the parameters of that IP group and ICMP group, TCP group, UDP group, EGMP. Like this, each has so many parameters in these groups: CMOD, transmission, SNMP, RMOD, remote network monitoring. So like that, this is the high level view of the MIBs. So, as I already said, the MIB comes like this, .1.3.6.1.2.1, like that. Let's say for an example, SNMP naming goes how? The number wise or the name wise? So how it is uniquely identified is by the number, but the number has the names also. These are the names. .1.3 means this is. So for an example, if you take this 1.3.6.1.2.1.7.1, means 1 is ISO, we have seen, 3 is ISO organizations, 6 is DOD, 1 is internet, 2 is management, 1 under that, 1 is MIB2, 7 is UDP, and 1 is UDP data graphs. So this is how the uniquely identifying the each object. And some more examples related to these object types. So these are the object IDs, and names are UDP in datagrams. The every object has its own identity, ID, name, and what is the type, and comments. Comments is the description. You have already seen the object type construct, so your object type will have all these details. So these are some more examples of the UDP MIB. UDP no port, sign errors, or like that. It will have tables also. We'll take an example of table also. The table is little common, little more informative. We will see how it looks like. And as I already said, there are standard MIBs itself. There are dozens or hundreds of MIBs are available. For example, SNMP SMI itself has an MIB, and MIB 1, it is obsolete. SNMP V2 SMI, MIB 2 is the one which is very standardized in current MIB. SNMP V2, because SNMP has multiple versions, V1, V2, V3. We'll see more in the coming slides. So SNMP V2 MIB is the RFC. This is the RFC number for that MIB. And list of MIBs, there are many more, like we are talking about the TCP group, TCP MIB, UDP MIB, IP MIB, IF MIB, Entity MIB, and and alarms, MIB. So let us actually take a look at the whole MIB as a single file so that you will get a better understanding. Are you able to see the screen, UDP MIB definitions?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So the this is, I'm taking an example of UDP MIB. This is a standardized RFC MIB because there are standard MIBs and proprietary MIBs. Proprietary means Cisco, for example, has its own MIB, right? So our Juniper or any company. Like that, each device and for each module means group of information will have its own MIB. So MIB will have its own imports. So where from where the types are imported and the description of the module entity. As we have already seen the module entity, what it will have, that these details we have already seen. So, and object types we have seen already in datagrams. And here in this MIB, let us take a look at the table so that you will get the feel for the table also. Table is defined like this. Table will have an entry. This entry will have connection for these columns because table will have rows are the actual data. Column names are the these names, object types. So this, let's say for example, if you talk about this UDP table, the name of the table is UDP endpoint table. This UDP endpoint table will have an entry. Every table will have entry. So in that entry, these are the columns. These columns are defined like in a sequence and its type, object type. And each object type is fully defined like this. You can take a look at, because in the Google you can, if you put UDP MIB, you will get this one. So this is how the MIB looks like, and we can write our own MIB also for our own purposes. Let us go back to the presentation.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. A few participants are requesting to increase like voice level, sir. So they are saying like they could not hear you properly.
Oh yeah, thanks for the information. I will increase the voice.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, list of MIBs are shown here, and we have already seen the example of MIB, and as we have seen the open source NMS, which is freely available, and it supports multiple protocols and multiple devices or the multiple technologies. And this is the NetSNMP SNMP for writing the agents, that is client side, this is the server side. So this is an open source freely available package or the source code. It is called NetSNMP. It has been developed over the decades, and it supports all versions of the SNMP, SNMP V1, V2, and V3. V3 has more security features. V1 was basic. V2C has a little security, but it's only community-based. But V3 is the better protocol from the security point of view. And it supports both IP protocols, IPv4 and V6. And it has already implementation of all standard MIPS. Standard MIPS means whatever we have seen, the RFC MIPS. RFC MIPS like the IF MIP or the TCP MIP or SNMP MIP. So the different MIPS are already implemented in this NetSNMP. And not only this freely, it is highly extendable. If we, as I have been saying, we can write our own MIB, we can actually write our own MIB and use this NetSNMP to generate our own code. It gives the skeleton code, and we can write the specific implementations for each object. So like that, the NetSNMP provides a service of free SNMP implementation. And this is supported on Linux or Unix-like operating systems. And it is supported on the Microsoft Windows also. So this is freely downloadable, and it supports multiple operating systems also. It generates the skeleton code. We'll see more, by the time we will not be able to see more on the NetSNMP. The references has the link for this one. You can take a look at that NetSNMP if you are interested. Yeah, but SNMP is widely used, but it has some limitations. The limitations are it is stateless, because every time you need to give all the information, and it is connectionless. Means when you send a packet, you will not get the acknowledgement. Obviously, SNMP is running on top of the UDP. So because of that, there is no acknowledgement. If you are going for the connection oriented or for the reliable communication, for that, you need to use the other protocol. So because SNMP is using the UDP, it is connectionless or the unreliable it supports, but it is simple. And it has no it does not support more configuration data. We'll see what is that more configuration. As in the beginning of this session, I said we need to collect all the configuration information of a network node or the managed node. So that is not supported by the SNMP. SNMP supports a lot of functionality, but these kind of functionalities are not supported by SNMP. So for that, in fact, we can take a look at the network requirements. The ISO has standardized some of the important requirements. So it needs to have ease of use, distinction between configuration and state data. And it has to fetch the configuration and the state data separately. State data means the device is, whether it is up or down, that kind of state, for example. But the configuration means how many interfaces are there, or whether you can configure the whole device. So that is the configuration. So configuration transactions across devices. So these are the transactions, whether you want to actually apply the configuration. Configuration deltas, if you want to have a different configurations, version 1, version 2, like that, you need to have the deltas. And dump and restore the configuration. If there is any problem, you want to restore it to the, restore back to the other configuration. All these are the requirements of the network operators. And before applying the configuration, the manager, the NMS, manager means managed NMS. So the NMS needs to validate the configuration. So it needs to validate and then only apply it. And configuration database schemas. So it needs to have its own database schema. Comparing the configurations, it can compare, it needs to compare the configurations like the deltas, role-based. So different roles, the network administrator or operator. Administrator needs to have more access. Operator needs to have lesser access. So like that, I mean, in fact, SNMP supports some of these requirements, but not all. Consistency of access control list. So the access control, so that consistency needs to be maintained. And multiple configuration sets. So these are the network operator requirements. Because of that, there is another protocol called NetConf, Network Configuration Protocol. It runs on the, you can see this diagram. NetConf allows retrieving state and configuration data, it allows. And it manipulates the, both the configuration and the state data on the network devices. This diagram, you can take a look at. The client is there. The client can send and receive the data to the server. Server is nothing but a managed device, that is network node. It can be any network node. So this needs to have the network and netconf configuration data store. And this is a model using the YAML. As we have seen already in the SNMP, SNMP and netconf are both almost same or similar, but netconf has features extra added. The comparison we'll see more into the coming slides. The comparison is SNMP is lighter. Sometimes the IoT devices require that. We'll see specificness of the IoT devices also. So the netconf actually runs on top of this protocol stack. So that transport there, we set the UDP, but netconf runs on top of TCP. TCP, SSH, or TLS, and on because it is secure. And on top of that, it is the RPC communication, remote procedure call. And this remote procedure call information is a model using the YAML, that is the XML data. So we'll see more details. So for example, it can be a get config operation or the edit configuration operation. So the configuration data is given for that operation. So like SMI we said, here it is YAML. Yeah, Raju, I am not able to see the actual chart box.
Sir, I think below the slides you have chart option now, sir. Could you see that?
Because.
Sir, I think we have to come out to the presentation. Oh, if you double.
Okay, yeah. I mean, let me complete the presentation and then we can go to the chart.
Yeah, sure, sir.
So netconf works on SSH transport protocol, and it provides end-to-end connectivity, ensures reliable delivery of messages. Netconf uses XML encoded remote procedure calls. There we said in SNMP it was the network messages. We'll see the more in the netconf. Netconf is XML encoded remote procedure calls, RPCs. And the RPC layer provides mechanism for encoding RPC calls and notifications. So netconf provides various operations to retrieve and edit configuration data from network devices. And the content layer consists of configuration and state data, which is XML encoded. The schema of the configuration and and state data is defined in a data modeling language called YAML. We'll see more on the YAML. As we said in the SNMP, it is the SMI. So where we have seen the MIB, here the data is in the YAML. So but the YAML is internally uses the XML, and RPC is the communication mechanism. So netconf provides a clear separation of configuration and state data. The configuration data resides within a netconf configuration data store on the server. So let us understand more by the comparison. So at the high level, very high level, both are same. Netconf and SNMP does the same management of the network devices. So if you see the upper part of this diagram, network manager is the left side, and the right side is the managed device of the network node. So they are over the network using the SNMP, it is managed. Similarly, the netconf also manages the, this is the right, left side is the network manager, and right side is the managed device. And this is by the management modules. This is what the difference, because it is the RPC. If you have already used RPC, you can know that their RPC are in Java, it is RMI. It is by the API contact. It is not as a network message. So SNMP, as I said already, SMI V2 modules, MIB modules are the object modules. So SNMP manager, NMS, and this is SNMP agent of the network node. So here it goes by the SMI V2, where here netconf uses the YAM modules. So netconf client, it can be our NMS or manager, it can be a different name, but same synonyms. So netconf server. So this is the netconf server. It is at the network node or the network element. So any element it can be. So the protocol layers, as already said, the netconf runs on top of the TCP and SSH, and it uses the XML encoded message. It has four layers: content, operations, messages, and the transport. So the left side is the NMS, that is the client or the manager. The right side is the managed device or the network node or any node, any element. So it needs to have the configuration, operational data, or any statistics. So this is the netconf data store, because the protocol what we are using here, it is the netconf. The earlier what we talked about is SNMP. There we said it is the MIB. Here it is the netconf data store. So in SNMP, it is where binds. So the object types you have seen. Here it is the XML subtrees in the netconf. We'll see more in the coming slides. So the operations are RFC defined in the SNMP, whether it is the get or set like that. Those are the operations in the SNMP. Where it is in the YAML defined, get config or the edit config or the copy running config or the kill the configuration or the, apply the configuration. There are different operations defined in the YAML. This is for the netconf. And in the messages, meaning SNMP, the network message, SNMP messages, like HTML message, it goes as a network message, PDU, protocol data unit. So whereas in the netconf, it is in a remote procedure call, RPC, API call. So that's what the difference between the SNMP and the netconf. And there the transport in SNMP is UDP, in the transport for the netconf is the SSH on top of TCP. So as already said, YAML is the data modeling language, and it is similar to the SMI, and it actually has a different configuration data and state data, RPC calls. YAML modules define the data exchanged between the netconf client and server. A module comprises a number of leaf nodes, because there we said different objects and the tables and the object identifier, the tree we have seen. Here also it is the same tree, but the naming is different. There we say object or object type or object identifier. Here it is leaf. Leaf will have the value. Leaf list means the same type of list, and the only leaf means it is the just some data, whether it is a string or the integer, that kind of data. And list means it is a complex data structure. It can have any type of list or leaves also. Or container, as the name itself is self-explanatory, it can contain the leaf leaves and leaves also. We'll see an example also. So YAML module can import definitions from other modules, as we have already seen the MIB importing definitions from the other MIBs. So similarly, YAML also can import definitions, and constraints can be defined in the data nodes. And YAML module, it can model differently for the configuration data and the state data, because there are different operations. Get and get config is different. And if you see this diagram, here the left side is the MIB module, which is used by the SNMP, and the right side is the YAML module, and it is used by the netconf. And Yeah, and I think with this information, you will get more understanding of the NetConf because I would like to cover the other network architecture also. So the protocol layer comparison here, if you see the object type, as we are saying, the data definition statement, notification type, notification statement is in the YAN. And as we said, set or get next or get bulk or these kind of operations are in the netconf and YANG. They are the RPC statements, edit config, copy config, or get config, or the kill config, like that, the operations. And yeah, notifications are like that. And as already said, UDP and the difference is SSH and TCP. This is the example. So if we take an example of toaster meat, I mean bread toasting, for example, if we take, so it will have an toaster MIB. We can take an toaster MIB. Yeah, our YANG module begins with the header information followed by identity definitions. We have an example here. So this is the right side, you can see. So the different types of breads are there. This is the graphical visualization of the toaster, I mean the YANG module. Similarly, in the SNMP, it is in a MIB, toaster MIB. So the leaf nodes are toaster manufacturer, means whatever the actual information, the string or integer, that is called leaf node. So leaf nodes has a type and optionally a description default value. Yeah, so the operations RPC definition, RPC means remote procedure call. So the operations are the make toast or cancel toast or toast done. So the make toast means toaster doneness, means how much is toasted, toaster type, what type of toasting it is, and canceling, input output is the parameter, toast done, whether it is done or not. So this is the YANG module for the toaster MIB. With that, you can understand more on the NetConf and YANG. Let us take a look at the flexible network architecture, because network, there are two types of networks. One is the conventional network or the traditional network. Traditional network, whatever we are using, the in fact, IPv4, IPv6, IPv4, V6, we can use on the SDN also, software-defined networks. So these software-defined networks supports all types of protocols, but the architecture is different. It is flexible and powerful. We will see how it is. Because of SDN, applying for IoT has multiple benefits. We'll see it. So I'll describe with the introduction of the SDN and why SDN is required, the limitations of the conventional or the traditional networks, and what is the approach of the SDN or in terms of the benefits, and the OS for the networks. Means the we'll go get into the architecture of the SDN, and we'll see a little details of the data plane of the SDN to understand SDN, and the protocol used for the SDN. OER config is the name of the management configuration protocol, like we'll see more in the coming slides. So the as already said, SDN provides the efficient way of centralized networking management, and it reduces the operating costs. We'll see how it does. So as the SDN runs in a central place, it can actually direct the traffic without relying on the hardware. And basically, the functionality of the network comes into the software. Because of that, it provides a lot of flexibility. So that is the I mean, high level introduction of the SDN, but why do we need the SDN? What are the limitations of the traditional networks? Means the traditional networks or the conventional networks, they are complex architecture, means they are static and follows the complex architecture. So everything within the same box, we will see what it is in the coming slides. And inconsistent policies, because every device or box has different policies, and inability to scale also. On demand, we cannot scale also. That is the limitation. And vendor dependence. Vendor dependence means each company or the vendor, like for example, Cisco or IBM, 3Com, Broadcom, Juniper, every company has different, even protocols also, different way of operating of the device. So if we are using the Cisco boxes, we need to understand Cisco's way of handling the devices or Cisco's proprietary protocols. So like that, the dependence has grown. In fact, that is the actual reason of the basic network research also has got into problems. So that is why SDN is proposed, and it is already accepted by the industry, and multiple industries are using it. We will see more into the slides, coming slides. So the approach, as already said, it provides the adaptability and the automation. The automation of the configuration or the monitoring, of monitoring can be done automatically. It does the maintainability from the central place, and the model management is also possible, and mobility is possible because the devices can be moved. How it is, we'll see. And the integrated security because more functionality is in the software. I mean, in fact, not only more, the actual control plane comes into the software itself, we'll see. So because of that, we can apply multiple security policies also. And on-demand scaling, because it supports the virtualization also, the on-demand scaling, instead of the actual hardware, it can even support the virtual network devices. We'll see how it is. So in the other terms, instead of the pure networking terms, we can look at the benefits in the general user benefits. Yeah, so I already talked about centralized controlling, because there is a controller. Basically, as said, SDN separates the data plane and control plane. Because of that, the controller, the device which actually runs in the control plane, it can have more efficiency or the better control. That is why it provides a centralized control, and infrastructure management is better compared to the conventional networks. And the automation is better because you are viewing the software in the centralized place. So the automation can be augmented, means increased. And as already said, the security can be increased because of the softwareization of the network functionality. So the centralized management, operational efficiency, better hardware use enables the reduced cost and reduced hardware management and cost. You can extend the life of existing hardware because you have shifted the decision making into the SDN controllers. We'll see what are those SDN controllers, and already talked about the virtualization because it gives the cloud ready infrastructure. So let us see from the conventional or the traditional networks. The traditional networks, you can see this network diagram. So this network diagram, these switches are connected, or whether it can be a routers or any network devices are connected like this. So these devices have everything within that one. Everything in the sense, there are three layers. Three layers means you can see each box or the device has three colors. The bottom color is blue. specialized packet forwarding hardware, and on top of that operating system, on top of that apps. Apps can be different apps. So it can be a load balancing or the different security apps or the network apps or the routing apps or different apps. So basically the operating system, this operating system also specific to the vendor. Cisco operating system is called iOS, it is well known, and Juniper operating system is called Junos, and there are different other vendors have different other operating systems. So basically to show, to inform that operating system is also different for different vendors, and that is how the complexity has increased. So the box is complex to actually manage. That is why the network has, I mean, the research has come to saturation, and after the SDN, it has actually growing. So if we see more into the each device, so as already seen, the billions of gates and millions of lines of source code. So that is all into each box, each device. So they are complex to change. Actually, if you have to change something, then all that needs to be changed, or it needs to be understood. So dynamically, if you have to change some network conditions or the policies, it is difficult to do it in the traditional or the conventional network devices. So what is the idea behind this SDN is, network devices with the internal details are shown here. So in the SDN, so the all the operating system is moved to a central place. We can call it network operating system. And the apps are moved on top of this network operating system. The whole thing is read, and the control programs runs in a single device. It is called controller. We will see more into the coming slides. So the network devices are left only with the hardware, the decision making, whether to send. All the decision making information is passed from the NOS, that is network operating system. The boxes are very simple, and so that the dynamic changing or the whatever you want to do, you can do more into the software. This is a software. The NOS, network operating system, and the control programs are running in the controller. And these blue boxes are just hardware devices. They are switches. So very light devices. These can be a brain and the arms. We'll see more into the slides. So the conventional networks, they actually talk to each other device to get into the details of the protocols. But in the SDN, they are actually given by the controller. The network operating system provides them. So they don't need to actually remember anything. They only do what is asked to do. So basically, the data plane and the control plane is totally separated by the this architecture. SDN does that one. So in the data plane, only the switching or the data handling devices reside. In the control plane, it is the controllers. So it is all software, it is hardware. So you can see more from this diagram. So the conventional networks are like this. The devices have both green and blue. Whereas the software approach is the networking devices are only blue and the controllers are green. I mean, it is the other way. The controllers are shown in the blue and green are the switches. So this is the architecture of the SDN. There are three planes in this. The bottom is the data plane and the middle is the control plane. Controllers sit here. So the applications are in this application plane. So all the load balancing or the security IDS, IPS, firewalls or the network applications come into this application plane, and they communicate with the controller and the using the northbound API. It is called the REST API, representational state transfer. And the southbound is the open flow. It is very unified. It is the same. It is not vendor specific. It is independent. That is where the value of the SDN. So no vendor can have any specific stuff there. So it is all independent, unique. So that is called southbound API. It is the open flow. And along with the SDN, there is an virtualization also. Like the traditional virtualizations, the switch or the router or firewall, IDS, IBS, load balancer, or any network device can be virtualized. Virtualization means like the virtual boxes. In the virtual box, we have different virtual machines. In virtual machine, can run a operating system. That operating the VM has its own operating system, its own network functionality. So for example, one VM can run one switch and another VM can run a router and another VM can run a firewall. So like that, the network devices also can be virtualized. Means if you take a look at this, the modern approach of computing, in the modern approach, we have different VMs running different operating system, Windows VM, Linux VM, or Mac, like that. You can actually virtualize the network devices also using the VMs. So network apps, different apps can run on different VMs. So this is the addition, I mean, addition to the SDN. SDN supports virtualization. So the modern approach is the QoE, quality of experience. This is different from quality of service. Quality of experience means the perception of the user. I mean, how he's, understanding how happy he is or how annoyed he is, the perception, it cannot be measured by a tool. Whatever can be measured by a tool is the quality of service, whether it is the bandwidth or the response time or different parameters which can be measured by the tool. That is the quality of service. So the all that can be sent to the NFV and the SDN, whatever just talked about the NFV, and that goes into the network devices. So the SDN network looks like this, the controllers and the switches, and these are the actual end systems. So switches connects to the servers or the laptops. And these are the internals of the SDN switches. So SDN switches have only the flow tables. So which we are populated by the controllers, whatever to be done. And the flow tables looks like this. It has different fields. And these different fields actually, matching itself has multiple fields. In the conventional routing tables, it is only based on the destination address. Whereas in the SDN, match can be done based on multiple parameters. For example, here, ingress port, outgress source, or Ethernet source address, or Ethernet type, IP port, or the IPv4 source destination, IPv6, or the port numbers. This is just a few matching fields. It can be extendable to any number. So like that, the flow rule can be prioritized, or the statistics, counters, and the instructions, what needs to be done, timeouts. So like that, flow tables has these details. And like flow tables, it has group tables and meta tables. And one flow table can give it to the other flow table because of the different processing. And this is in the incoming way, and the same way in the outgoing way also it is done. And as we are saying, multiple flow tables, why? Because if you see this example, between the source and destination, source address, destination address, one flow table can process it. And more into this, I mean, like the between the source address, what is the flow, TCP flow, UDP flow, or other flows? That is the table one. In that, the next table two, it can be within the TCP, what are the other application layer protocols, FTP, SMTP, or whether different protocols are in UDP, SNMP, or RTP. Like that, so different tables can process in at a different level. So open flow protocol has three different divisions. controller to switch, asynchronous and symmetric. Basically, it is same across the universe. Means it is not vendor dependent. So the SDN controllers, we said there are multiple controllers. Controllers depending on the company or depending on the implementation language, there are different controllers. You can see more into different books. So the what we talked about, the open flow, that is OF, open flow is the southbound communication protocol. In the northbound, because we talked about the architecture, in the architecture, these are the three different layers. This is the northbound I am talking about. This is called REST API. So it is a representational state transfer. So there are six conditions for that. Those six conditions, if they follow, any protocol can be used there. For HTTP is one example. So yeah, OF config is the configuration protocol in the SDN. So SDN, same thing like netconf and yang, here little extra on top of that is called OF config. You can see there is there are links given in the references to know more about the OF config. As we talked about management protocols for the IoT management, as you know already, for any research we need to start with the books, and the next thing is the survey papers, and the latest surveys are better. And the IEEE communication surveys or the ACM surveys are the best journals for the survey papers. And this is the survey paper, latest survey paper. It has many open challenges listed for the IoT management protocols, because there are multiple attempts already made for the IoT management protocols, like SNMP we talked about. There is a LNMP. Lightweight network management protocol for the NetConf, it is a light, I mean, NetConf light, or for SDN, it is called the SDIM, software defined IoT network management protocols. So, like that, there are different attempts, and on top of that, there are multiple open challenges. If anyone is interested to look into the IoT management protocols, there is another paper of a Web of Science or a CIE paper. It also lists these open challenges. So these are the references. I have tried to give all the links for the whatever material I have used. Thank you. Questions, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for providing the information related to the network management. So I think, of course, people might have understood a little bit of on the low noise. That's what they say. There are some couple of questions, sir, on the chat window.
Sure.
Shall I read it out, sir?
Yeah, I'm going to the chat box, sir, because I just stopped the presentation.
Please go through it, sir.
Sir, please increase the volume. Oh, okay, that is why.
That is okay, sir. The question is, any simulator available to work on SDN?
There is a simulator. It is called MiniNet. It is because we don't have the SDN actual networks in our institutions. That is why it is very important to use the MiniNet. MiniNet is again an open source emulator, because there is a difference between the simulator and emulator. As you know, emulator is more near to the reality. So MiniNet is an emulator. Whatever you run on a Linux box or a Linux system, you can do the same operations on the MiniNet also. So MiniNet has a lot of features, and over the time, it has grown to a very good shape now.
Yeah, along with the MiniNet Wi-Fi, sir, I think we have the SDN WISE also.
Okay.
Just for the participants' information, sir. Yes.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
May I read out another question, sir? There is one more question.
Sure.
For configuring open NMS, knowledge of Linux needed or not? I repeat the question, sir. For configuring open NMS, knowledge of Linux is needed or not?
Yeah, Linux is not required, but the network knowledge is required, because when you are giving the discovery, for example, you need to know the IP addresses, because for understanding the IP address, one needs to know the basics of the networks. So when you give the IP address, whether it is the network portion of it, it actually discovers. When you install an open NMS, it automatically discovers. But the discovery has problems because it does the ICMP flooding inside, and that ICMP flooding, some devices actually disable the ICMP. Because of that, it can get stuck also. So as a manual process, you can actually configure that one. For OpenNMS, Linux knowledge is not required, but network knowledge is required, as you are going to manage the network devices.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, sir.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot for sharing your knowledge and your skills and providing some insights on the network management system. Of course, the same concepts will be applied for the IoT network too. So I think the participants have rightly received the information. So let us wind up the session, sir, now. Yeah.
Thank you,
sir. Sir, may I take the poll, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead, sir.
Participants are requested to give the feedback for first session as well as second session for today's first and second session as mentioned. First, I am starting the feedback for this particular session. So session by Saifullah, sir, Dr. Saifullah, sir. Please give the feedback. Then I think I will take the feedback for the previous session by Mukhopadhyaya, sir. Professor Mukhopadhyaya, sir. I repeat the announcement. First, we are taking the feedback for session 11, that is today's second session. Once this is done, I will take the feedback for the previous session.
And one more announcement, please. In the today's afternoon session, after the Professor Udgata sir's session, then we'll have our little bit on practice session and the mock quiz. So please do attend the mock quiz so that we can counter verify your attendance with the mock test participants. So the mock test has to be attended by the registered participants only, please. I'll send the link at 3:30. So please do attend the mock test so that we can conduct the actual online test in the tomorrow's afternoon session. The polling is in process, Suhasini ma'am. So please complete that polling. That is the feedback only. Polling is basically the feedback.
So participants are requested to give the feedback for session 11. So that once this is done, I will start the polling for the previous session. So we are at 65%.
Yes, Sajid.
So participants who have given the feedback for this session are requested to stay back. In the same session, I am going to take the feedback for the previous session also. Please don't exit the session.
Bhuvan Atul Savan, sir, I think you're looking for a feedback link. Okay. Please share email ID. You want the email ID of Dr. Mohammed Saifullah, sir?
Sir?
I think somebody is asking your email ID, sir.
Sir,
Can you please put it in your chat box, sir?
Sure, sir. I'm writing. Raju, can you help me? Because the chat window is not opening here.
Sure, sir. Please tell. So, would you please spell the...
FEIFULLAH@UOI.ac.in.
FEIFULLAH@UOHYD.ac.in, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So I think we are going to close the poll for this session. If anybody would like to give the feedback, please do that. The poll for this session will be up for another 1 minute. Later on, I think we will move to the feedback for the previous session by Professor Mukhopadhyay, sir.
Suhasini, ma'am, what is the problem, ma'am? You are not getting the poll option, ma'am. You can type it on the chat window, ma'am, if you cannot speak, no problem.
So,
can you see this message, Srinivasa?
Madam, you could, I have given, yeah, you could speak out, madam. You could speak out. Suhasini, madam.
Sorry, sir. Just now I got it. Sir, just
got,
now I got the
email. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Yeah.
Just we are closing the feedback for this session. So I repeat, now I think I am going to launch the feedback form for the previous session by Professor Mukhopadhyay, sir. I am closing this feedback form. Participants are requested to give the feedback for the previous session. Session 10 by Professor Mukhopadhyay, sir. It's up.
So once we have completed the polling process, then we will meet at 2:30 p.m. sharply, please. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for the feedback. We'll have the next session at 2:30 p.m. Thank you.